submitted for the approval of the Midnight Pals, created by Bitter Corella.
We have a special guest storyteller tonight.
That's right, it's me, your bro, Patricia Highsmith.
Hi, Patricia.
And Patricia's here to tell us all.
Mr. King, did you bring your train set like I asked?
Oh, it's not a train set. It's a Hornby AA gauge scale replica of a Seaboard Railroad Alco RS-2 locomotive.
Now, I want you to lay the tracks in a circle around the fire, would you guys?
Sure. Edgar and Clive, you take that side. Mary...
I'm not 10 years old, Steve. I don't play with toy trains.
It is not a toy train. It is a Hornby RS-2.
This is kind of fun.
Oh, I can't get my piece to fit.
You got it upside down there, dude.
Oh. I have a question. What's a train?
Oh, okay. You know how that crappy rockets guy keeps saying he's going to make driverless cars? Well, not everybody remembers, but we actually used to have them. They were called trains.
What? Trains had drivers?
You guys know trains are still a thing, right?
And we'll not see their like again.
I love a driverless car. I could pretend like my dog was driving. One time, I tried to get Trixie Belle to drive my mom's car, but she crashed into some guy.
Say, Steve, weren't you hit by a car once? Yeah, I remember the news story, because the driver said he was distracted by a dog in the vehicle. Ain't that a coincidence?
We'll talk later, Dean.
Anyway, are you guys done setting up that railroad?
Yep. Neat job. Who wants the controls?
Oh, I'll do it. I'll make the trains run on time.
One more thing. Bros, I'd like you to meet my co-storytellers.
Oh, you're not going to put them on my...
This is Guy.
Oh, God.
And Bruno.
What are those?
Guy is an Eastern flat coil, and Bruno is a Greyfoot lance tooth.
Oh, I thought they were snails.
They are. Patricia's got a thing about snails.
Now look here, Patricia. I want those gosh darn snails off my gosh darn train.
No, they're my companions for the evening. No snails, no story.
But there's nothing in the rules that says a snail can't tell a story, Steve.
Oh, just tell them not to get slime on the smoke generator.
Submitted for the approval of the Midnight Society, I call this story The Tale of the Strangers on a Train. You can start the train now, Mr. Lovecraft.
Choo-choo!
Actually, it's a diesel locomotive, so...
Now, on this train, two disgusting, slimy people, represented here by these magnificent mollusks. These two guys haven't seen each other before in their lives, but they happen to meet, quite randomly, on this rail journey. Everyone got that?
Yeah, they're on a train, and they're strangers. I don't think we really needed the snail mobile repertory theatre to explain that, Patricia.
Hi, Guy. Hi, Bruno.
And these strangers happen to sit across from each other in the dining car. There's a bit of moldy lettuce for you, Guy. Bruno has a more sensitive hepatopancreas, so he's having the vintage mushroom casserole. Bon appetit, Bruno.
Yeah. Oh, my beautiful RS-2.
So these strangers get to talking about, I don't know, small talk.
Oh. I'm sorry. Did I accidentally brush you with my pseudopod? My name's Bruno. What's yours?
Hi, Bruno. I'm Guy.
What do you do, Guy?
Oh, the usual, you know. Radula scraping, secreting mucopolysaccharides.
When one of them suddenly changes the subject.
Hey, Guy. Did I ever tell you about my idea for the perfect murder?
The perfect murder? Is there such a thing?
I don't think there can be. Without the thought someone might catch you, there'd be no thrill.
Ah, but if the perfect murder didn't exist, it wouldn't be perfect. Non-existing would be a pretty glaring imperfection, so it must exist. Mary, what are you not going to tell me that that's a ontological fucking bollocks?
Ooh, switchblade in 3, 2,
Mary?
Oh, yeah, no.
Whoa.
She didn't even slash him.
Mary, are you all right? You look kind of flashbacky. Flashbacky, flashbacky, flashbacky.
I don't feel well.
Don't worry, darling. I know it's terrifying for your delicate constitution, but technology's our friend. You know, soon these railways will crisscross the world.
Yeah, fascinating. Can't wait.
Did you happen to catch the serial number of the locomotive? Have a strange urge to write it down in a notebook. Does anybody have a notebook?
Oh, take one of mine. I always carry a notebook or three. I'm something of a poet. Percy B. Shelley. At your service.
Edward Ellicker Williams. How kind, thank you. Do you happen to know the number of the locomotive?
It's one. It's the first fucking train in the world. Of course it's one.
Allow me to introduce my beloved, Mary Wollstonecraft Godwin.
Sup, fucker.
Excuse her colourful language. Mary fancies herself a writer too, you know.
Oh, really? How frightfully amusing.
I'm working on something about a massive monster that destroys the life of an annoying, patronising dude.
That is lovely. And this is my own betrothed, Jane Cleveland.
Hello.
Sup.
Tell you what, why don't you girls get to know each other? While Percy and I retire to the port and cigars carriage to discuss the more technical points of steam engineering.
Ooh, capital idea, Mr. Williams.
Oh, please. Call me Lieutenant Williams.
And may I say, your girlfriend's a babe.
Ladies and gentlemen, brace yourselves. This train is about to reach dangerous record speeds of up to 12 miles per hour. I must remind you that science is divided over whether such unimaginable velocities will cause fatal brain damage.
Fucking nerds.
I know, right? Ed had me up at 5 a.m. to come and stand in this bloody open-top soap crate, getting pulled along by a kettle on wheels. I could kill him some days.
I ever tell you about my idea for the perfect murder?
No, because we're total strangers.
That's the point. Have some vodka, Jane. I've got a flask here. You have anyone special in your life?
Well, Ed's with the East India Company, so we move about a lot. Not much time to make friends.
Oh, I didn't mean friends. I mean, like, someone you want to murder.
Yeah, Ed.
Huh. Most people don't answer honestly until I've given them a bit more vodka.
Really? But everyone must want to murder someone, mustn't they? I mean, otherwise they wouldn't have to make it illegal.
That's exactly what I said. Too bad you can't murder Ed, because the constables would know it was you. You'd be like the prime suspect.
Yeah, it's too bad. Give us another swig.
Sure. But what if, by coincidence, somebody else murdered Ed. And they did it while you had a totally solid alibi. No suspicion at all.
I suppose I wouldn't be too sorry about that. But who else would murder Ed? Everyone likes him and his stupid train facts. Look, even your Percy's besotted with him already.
Oh, that's Percy. Falls in love with something new every couple of weeks. Or someone. But if Ed got murdered, right, by a total stranger with no connection to either of you, they'd never find him. They could leave clues all over the place, but there'd be no motive, no link, nothing to follow. They'd be stumped, right?
I mean, sure, but that's not terribly likely, is it?
Well, supposing, hypothetically, I mean, it wasn't a total coincidence. Like, if you put someone up to it, someone you just ran into, on a train, for instance, someone you'd never seen before and would never see again.
Right. Hypothetically, though, why would this person do that for me? Do they want money?
Oh, no. Money can be traced. This hypothetical stranger only wants you to do a favour for me. I mean, in return.
What sort of favour?
Well, like you said, everyone's got someone they want murdered, haven't they?
You're saying...
That's how you do the perfect murder. You swap it with someone else's. A murder swap.
Can I have some more vodka? And the way he talks about bloody trains.
One day, Jane, they'll lay a railway across the bottom of the sea to the continent.
What? So as well as getting shaken about in a glorified mine car at the speed of a sloth on opium, we'll all fucking drown.
I'd like to see more of the continent. If Ed drowned on the way, that'd be even better.
You know, Percy and I have this other boyfriend, Byron, and he's got this twink, John Polidori, who's got this house in Switzerland that we go to sometimes. Me and Percy and Byron and Byron's other girlfriend, Claire, who's actually sort of my stepsister. Anyway, this house, the Villa Diodati, it's right by a big, deep, dangerous lake.
Are you serious?
Well, no, I guess not. I wouldn't really want Percy dead. He gets on my tits and he writes soppy poetry. And there was that time he got rusticated for contumacy.
No, rusticated for contumacy?
I know, right? And he's a total fucking wimp. But he's my wimp, you know? I just wanted to talk about my murder swap idea.
Oh, pity. I'd absolutely drown Ed. Shove him in the nearest body of water and watch his face while he thrashes about.
No, you can't do that. You've got to tie up his limbs and wrap him up and weight him down properly. Otherwise, bits of him will float back up as soon as he starts to decompose.
Wow. You've looked into this stuff.
Did you just accidentally on purpose brush your hand against my leg?
Maybe.
Hello again, ladies. Enjoying your frivolous girl talk?
Hello again, Jane. Mary, Edward knows all sorts of astonishing facts about steam engines. Oh, and I wrote a love poem.
Oh, Percy, you shouldn't have. It's fucking embarrassing.
Go on. Read it.
Yeah, come on, Mary. Let's hear what your devoted wimp wrote about you.
My love is like a red, red rose. I met her on the train. She set my heart in passion's throes. Ugh. My gorgeous, lovely... Mary.
That's not...
Shut up, Percy. I was just inviting Jane and Edward to join us at the polycule in Switzerland this summer.
What? Really? You want to go ahead with the plan, then?
Oh, yeah. Plan's on.
What a splendid idea.
The... polydorical.
Oh, it's such spiffing fun. Come on, Edward. Let's go and introduce ourselves to the driver. See you later, Jane. And the other one.
Great. Now we're being pulled along at twinge neck speeds by a distracted driver.
I say, driver.
What? Ah!
Thanks for catching me.
We apologize for the sudden stop, ladies and gentlemen. The train appears to have struck a Conservative Member of Parliament.
Yes. Huh, I like trains now.
Wow, look at all the bits of him. Hey, is that his top hat down there?
Want me to go get it?
Careful!
Oh, there's a bit of his scalp still stuck to it.
Mary, get back on the train.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am happy to announce that the fragments of politician have been cleared from the track.
Mary!
There is no damage to the locomotive, and we can get back underway.
Mary?
As soon as I get this boiler going.
Mary? Climb back up. He's starting the engine.
Almost there. She's temperamental sometimes.
No. Mary?
Oh, Paul! My skirt's caught in the wheel!
And we're off.
Mary! Mary! Oh. Shit! Ah. Help! Ah. Help!
Ah.
Somebody! Ah. Cute golf chick overboard! You're all right.
Cute, Emma.
Your dress is ripped to shreds. Looks good. I've never met anyone like you, Mary.
Mary? Who's Mary? Look at my hat. I'm Sir William Huskisson. Mr. Speaker, will you kindly remind the Right Honourable Gentleman that children dying of cholera is actually good?
You're so cool.
I know, right?
Have a top hat. Go on. I risked my arse to get it for you. And you look hot in it.
Ladies and gentlemen, do not be alarmed. The train is about to enter a cinematically symbolic tunnel.
Oh, that feels nice.
So they agree that Bruno's gonna murder Guy's spouse in exchange for Guy murdering Bruno's.
What the fuck, Highsmith?
Huh?
Are you okay, Mary? You look like you've seen a ghost.
You haven't been talking to your mom again, have you?
I gotta go.
Weird. What's up with the goth chick?
Mary is as Mary does.
Broads, am I right? I tell you, when my wife storms off like that, it's either because I've done something wrong, or she has.
Jane! Oi, Jane!
What the hell? Mum, wake up from your drunken stupor. We've got burglars. Oh, Jesus. Get out, burglars. We've got no valuables. Mum sold them all, but I still have my dad's old bayonet. It's not sharp, but it'll give you a nasty case of tetanus. I'm coming in.
Jane, it's me.
Mary?
You look badass with that bayonet.
Mary? Why are you breaking into my house at 11:15 at night?
Well, when we formed the Midnight Society, we were going to meet at midnight, but Dean's dad won't let him stay out that late, so we meet at 11, and Steve wanted to call it the 11 o'clock Society, and I said that was a fucking stupid name. Then Edgar said it was always midnight somewhere, then Dan Simmons turned up saying time zones are a myth propagated by NASA global elitists to dupe the round earth sheeple, so I fucking upped him, and he ran away crying, and
bloody hell, Mary. What's happened to rattle your usual stoic demeanour? Did you have to break the window? Why not knock on the bloody door?
Didn't want to wake your mum.
So you chucked a 10-stone sundial through the front window.
Hello? Who's in there?
It's all right, Mum. It's only...
Oh, Mary Shelley. How nice to see you again. Jane still talks about you a lot, you know. Eh?
Mum!
Hello, Mrs. Cleveland. How do you do, Mrs. Cleveland?
Oh, will you stay for a cuppa? We're out of milk, but, well, I can put gin in it.
No, thank you, Mrs. Cleveland. Another time, Mrs. Cleveland. Thank you. Goodbye, Mrs. Cleveland.
It's all right. I know when I'm not wanted. I was young once. Eh? Eh?
No, not eh, Mum. I don't know what she's even doing here.
Whatever you say, chicken. I'll leave you two lovebirds to get reacquainted. Take care of her, Mary. Jane, if you're not in bed by midnight, come home. Eh?
Mary, what are you doing here? We agreed we'd stay away from each other.
We gotta go somewhere. Just to talk.
All right, as long as it's not... your mother's grave.
Don't worry, she's probably out haunting Jean-Jacques Rousseau. This is where I come to think.
Among other things, as I recall.
It's a comfortable grave. Nice springy moss.
I remember. Mary, we're not getting back together.
I know.
We weren't good for each other. And I've met someone else.
Oh? Who?
Are you kidding? If I told you that, you'd bloody shiv him. Or her, or them.
Yeah, I would.
You so would.
Fair enough.
You certainly would.
I'd stick that fucker. I don't even want you back. I'm not jealous. I'd just do it anyway.
I miss you sometimes.
Me too. Not very much. But I do.
Mary, what are we doing here?
Patricia Highsmith's telling a story at the Midnight Society meeting.
So? I'm still not coming to your stupid story club.
It's not stupid, it's just got a lot of stupid people in it. That's not all. Her story's called The Tale of the Strangers on a Train.
So?
So she's fucking onto us, Jane. She knows what we did last summer.
Oh my God. Are you sure? What do we do?
I don't know.
Someone's coming.
Fuck! Who is it?
Some weird bint in a dirty trench coat.
That's Highsmith. Well, at least we're already in a graveyard.
Excuse me, ladies. Oh, that's a lovely switchblade. Is that a Benjamin Huntsman original? Fine piece of engineering. You know, he was a clockmaker originally.
Aren't you supposed to be telling your story at the campfire?
Oh, my snails are on it. They've done this story 100 times. They know the script. You know, my wife's got a switchblade just like that, Miss,
Shelley.
No. Mary Shelley? Oh, it's an honor, Miss Shelley, to meet the author of, what was it, Dracula?
Frankenstein.
Right. Of course. Can't say I've read it myself. I don't go in for that, gothic horror. I'm more of a creepy psychological crime story type, you know? But my wife, she's a huge fan. She'll turn green when I say I met Mary Shelley.
Thanks.
And,
Jane Williams.
Jane Williams. Nay, Cleveland. Sure. Your reputation precedes you, don't it? Because your name comes up in a lot of sappy love poetry by that. What's his name? Romantic poet, floppy hair, Perry?
Percy.
That's it, Percy. Boy, he was really into you, wasn't he? Percy Bysshe Shelley. Huh, that's the same last name as you, Miss Shelley.
That's because...
No, wait, I remember now. You two were married.
That was more of a bureaucratic thing.
So, let me get this straight, so to speak. Percy was married to you, Mary, while writing all this schmaltz about you, Jane, and neither of you had a problem with that? I mean, here you are, shooting the breeze like old friends.
Fine with me.
Yeah, me and Percy weren't monogamous.
Ah, polyamory, I see. Not my thing, but my wife's into it. Say, is Percy around? She loves that poem about the skylark. She'd be thrilled if I could tell her I met him.
He's dead.
Oh, that's bad news. I'm sorry. How'd it happen?
He drowned.
Drowned. Yeah, that'll do it. Say, Miss Williams, didn't your fella Edward also drown?
Yeah, and before you pretend you don't know it already, yes, he went down in the same boat as Percy.
So he did. A tragedy, right? I mean, you two gals happened to lose your lousy men in the same accidental boat accident last summer. Down at, where was it? Switzerland, right? Lovely country. I tell you, I could eat that cheese with holes in it till I puked holes. Whereabouts were you? Don't tell me. The Via Deodorante?
Diodati.
Diodati. Gotcha. Right by Lake Geneva. Beautiful bit of water. Oh my, is that where you guys drowned? It must have been devastating for the both of you. I can't imagine. I mean, if I drowned, I think my wife would have moved on by the weekend, but a couple of, romantics, like you two.
Are you insinuating something, Patricia?
Insinuating? Insinuating? No, I'm just trying to get a clear picture here. I'm a crime writer. I'm interested in this stuff. No offense meant.
None taken.
All right. I'll leave you two to whatever you happen to be doing in the middle of the night at Mary's mom's grave. Which, by the way, I heard the wildest rumor about the things you've gotten up to here, Mary. No, I said, that's an urban myth, you know, playing on Mary's reputation as a rebellious goth girl and Percy's as a libertine with a shady past. What was it he got rusticated for?
Contumacy.
Contumacy, right. Nasty business. If I got rusticated for contumacy, my wife, well, I think she'd want to kill me. But those claims about your using this grave for unconventional purposes, there is some historical evidence. Would you believe that? Entries in Percy's diary, Mary's letters, and it does look like a nice comfy grave. Look at that moss there. May I?
Be Mum's guest.
Oh, that's lovely. I'm telling you, my back is in bliss here. Oh, I should get one of these for the wife. I can picture lying on this grave, gazing at the stars while your best gal... Oh, like I say, I'm sure it's only a well-evidenced rumor. But even if it's true, hey, love is love, right? Whether it's on a bed or a grave. Or at a Swiss villa.
Hello? Ah. Who is that?
Oh, shit. You woke Mum up.
Language, Mary?
Sorry, Mum.
Mary, what have I told you about bringing your friends round to make out on my tomb?
That it was cool.
Yes, but also to do it when I'm out. Otherwise, it's also what I believe you kids call cringe.
I wasn't going to make out with her.
Excuse me, are you Mary Wollstonecraft? This Mary's mom?
No, I'm Mary Wollstonecraft, feminist philosopher and radical political author defined by my own accomplishments.
I apologize, ma'am. I didn't mean to reduce you to your status as a mother there. Can I ask you a few questions? My name is Patricia Highsmith.
Miss Highsmith, what are your intentions towards my daughter?
Don't worry about that, ma'am. She ain't my type.
Oh, yes? What's wrong with her?
Nothing. She's a stunning gal. But, you know, even if I wanted to, it looks like I'd be at the back of a pretty long line. First, there was that poet Percy.
I remember him. Creepy, skinny, little nice guy. Never understood what you saw in him, Mary. Broken up, have you?
He died.
Oh, of course he did. I knew that boy wouldn't amount to anything.
Then, Byron.
Byron.
Lord Byron. He had a bit of class. I'd certainly have boffed him myself.
Oh, Mum!
If I hadn't died of an infection after giving birth to you.
Oh, is that how you died? You've never said.
And of course, young Jane here.
Jane!
Hello, Mrs. Wollstonecraft. How do you do, Mrs. Wollstonecraft? Please, thank you.
Wonderful to see you again, Jane. You keep hold of her this time, Mary, do you hear me? Or I might just snatch her up.
We're not back together.
Is that so? In that case, come over any time, Jane.
Mum!
Ah, so you, Mary, Junior, and you, Jane, were romantically involved.
It was just...
They were at it like little gothic rabbits, Miss Highsmith. I lost count of how many times I had to get the moss replanted.
I see. Young love. There's nothing like it. And was this before or after the unfortunate if convenient death of Mr. Shelley and Mr. Williams?
After.
We found solace in each other's arms.
And elsewhere...
Oh, Mum!
All right, dear. I won't embarrass you any longer. I'm off to throw plates at Henry James. Keep smashing the patriarchy, Mary.
Bye, Mum.
And Jane, I'll see you again soon, I hope. Unless my nitwit daughter dumps you again.
We're not.
Thank you, Mrs. Wollstonecraft. Goodbye, Mrs. Wollstonecraft. Please, thank you.
Say, your mom's an impressive lady, Miss Shelley. Explains a lot. I think I got what I need. Have a beautiful night, girls. Boy, is the wife gonna be thrilled when I tell her I met the gal who wrote Wuthering Heights. Just one more thing. How did you two meet?
Percy knew Jane's husband.
The common law husband. It wasn't serious.
Oh, so Edward was also a poet.
He was a lieutenant in the East India Company.
Yeah. People got all kinds of hobbies, I guess. I mean, I breed snails. My wife can't stand the things. But I just think they're neat.
Is this conversation going anywhere, Patricia?
Hmm? Oh, I'm just getting my thoughts together. You met for the first time at this Via Diarrhea?
Diodati.
That's right.
Let's get back to the story.
That must be the villa.
That half-dilapidated farmhouse. I expect so.
I can't wait to see Mary again. And Percy and everyone. And spend some quality heterosexual time with you, of course. You know, Mary once got false passports for two of her female friends so they could run away to France and live as a married couple.
Excuse me?
Well, one of them might have been a trans man, but we don't yet really have the terminology.
This Mary is involved with inverts. You should be careful, Jane. You know, unnatural relations can cause chronic delirium.
Only when it's done properly.
They also result in corruption and moral turpitude.
Such as?
Such as unnatural relations. Darling, has this Mary ever tried to incite anything improper with you?
You mean, are we banging? Yes, Edward, we're banging.
Oh, you're just gal pals. I see.
We did it all over our house, all over her house, and on her mum's grave. She rocked my world like the bloody Industrial Revolution, only with more steam.
Pure platonic gal pals. Glad to hear it.
Amazing.
Edward.
Mr. Shelley.
And Jane.
Hi, Percy. Hi, Mary.
Miss Wollstonecraft.
Hey, Jane.
How was the journey?
Delightful. We took a train as far as Dover.
Then 4.5 weeks getting dragged up and down hills by various ungulates.
Do you want to know what the number of the train was?
Was it, by any chance, 2?
Yes. I wrote it in that notebook you gave me. Look.
Hmm. Do you know, I'm more into boats now.
Oh, tell me more.
Fucking boats. I almost missed the train drivel.
Nice countryside. Is there, somewhere we can go when we want a bit of moral turpentine?
Yeah. There's a graveyard in the village. Don't know who Anne Malay de Saint-André was, but she's got a nice king-size mausoleum. We could go tomorrow. Percy won't notice. He'll probably be sailing on the lake all bloody day.
You're on. That is boat?
Yeah, cost a fucking bomb. Wouldn't mind, but he'll be into something else next week. Horse-drawn caravans or some shit.
Only, he won't be here in another week, Mary. The plan's still on.
Oh.
Isn't it?
Yeah, sure. That is, unless you're...
Oh, no, I was just making sure you were...
No, I'm cool.
Me too.
I mean, I'm fond of Percy, but all things considered, fuck it. Why not?
Cool. Except, Mary, if we go through with this, we're not supposed to see each other again.
Yeah, it's been fun.
What, that's it?
Jane, after I've done this for you, you'll be free. You won't need me.
I suppose not.
We've got this summer though, right? I mean, better to break things off while we're happy than stay together and wear ourselves down till we hate the sight of each other.
Sure.
You want to come in and bully Polidori for a bit?
I think I'll stay out here and watch the sunset. Feel like joining me?
Nah. Fucking hate sunsets.
Just one more thing.
That's what you said about the last thing.
Where did you get that stylish top hat, Jane?
You kept the hat I gave you. Fuck.
You gave her that? Oh, ain't that sweet. Can I snatch that off your head for a minute, Miss Williams?
How? Help yourself.
I'm thinking of maybe getting one of these for formal occasions. I'm usually more of a fedora gal, you know. Too bad it's on the big side. Right over my eyes. You know, this hat looks like it was made for someone with a bigger head. A guy, perhaps. What's that say on the label there? WH. That reminds me of something. Oh, yeah. William Huskisson. You know who that is?
No.
He was a politician who was hit and killed by one of the very first trains. Locomotive number one, in fact. Or Stevenson's Rocket, as it was nicknamed. Huskisson was crossing the tracks carrying a double bass, and the train driver never saw him because he said in his statement that he was distracted by a skinny, fop-haired poet who, now I come to think of it, must have looked something like your late fella, Miss Shelley. And another guy, a military type, who, tangentially, must have looked something like your late fella, Miss Williams.
Is this relevant, Patricia?
Relevant? Not necessarily. Just, you know, a tangent. I like tangents. My favorite trigonometric function. Did you know the square of the tangent is equal to... There I go again. Where was I? William Huskisson, MP. Tory centrist, you know, sat on so many fences his ass stank of creosote. He had this long, flowing gray hair that... Say, there's a piece of long gray hair right there on the hat band there, next to all the dried blood. And a bit of scalp tissue. And that mark there. See that? That looks a lot like a steam burn. Hey, you don't think this could have been Huskisson's actual top hat, do you? I mean, he was torn to bits by Stevenson's rocket. Arms, legs, all over the place. But the one thing they never found was his top hat. Several witnesses thought they saw it being removed from the scene by some goth chick. Boy, it looks like you've been wearing a piece of transport history right there on your head, Miss Williams.
What if I have been?
Well, if this is Huskisson's hat, and you, Mary, let's say, found it, and gave it to you, Jane, then wouldn't that mean you two first met on the very train journey that killed William Huskisson? Several months before you were together at the Via Duodenum.
Dear Darty.
Ladies, you've been lying to me. I believe that you, Miss Shelley, murdered Lieutenant Edward Ellica Williams, and I believe that you, Miss Williams, murdered Percy Bysshe Shelley.
That's a fascinating hypothesis, Patricia. Got any evidence?
Well, yeah, I got this hat here.
Oh. Oh, yeah. Fuck.
Good morning, Mary. Why, you've slept until almost six. You've missed a quarter of the day.
Yeah, I'd have missed more if you weren't making this racket.
Well, a sailor needs a hearty breakfast. Can't splice a main brace on an empty stomach.
Percy, you have literally no idea what a main brace is and have never spliced anything in your sheltered little life. Love you.
But I can learn. It's a sailor's life for me, Mary. All these years, I didn't even know I'd never found my true calling. What are your plans for today?
Oh, I thought me and Jane might take a stroll to the village, you know. Check out the cemetery. Fuck on some of the graves.
What a cracking wheeze.
Don't tell Ed.
You're truly a lucky woman, you know. Jane really is wonderful.
Yeah, I know.
The pinnacle of feminine excellence.
Yes, Percy, I get it. You like her.
A perfect specimen of all that's desirable.
All right, Percy, that's enough.
Yes, dear. Breakfast?
Just coffee.
I'll make it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Give me that, Percy. I know how she likes it.
So I hear.
Jane, tea. Darjeeling. Lukewarm.
Dick.
Actually, Ed, I was about to go for a turn around the village graveyard with Mary. I'll go get a pillow.
You're going sailing again, Percy.
Sailing? Oh, the boat. You know what? I think I've just completely gone off the idea of boats. What do you think of us getting a horse-drawn caravan?
Oh, for fuck's sake.
I say, Edward, do you want a boat? I'm never setting foot in that thing again.
Gosh. Well, why not indeed? I shall take it out after breakfast. Thank you, Shelley.
I got us a wedge-shaped pillow and a pot of scented oil and a bottle of vodka and a copy of the complete works of the Marquis de Sade with woodcuts.
What's that for?
Gal pal stuff. Come on, Mary. It's so bloody clueless. It'd be endearing if he wasn't such a cockhead. Which way is this graveyard?
That way. You go on, Ed. I'm just going to fetch some more booze. I'll catch up.
Don't be long.
You're really giving me your boat?
Oh, yes. Can't imagine what I ever saw in it.
Could you at least give me a driving lesson?
Oh, all right. One trip over the lake and back. Then you're on your own.
Good man. Sailing is pleasant, isn't it? How do you stop?
Oh, I generally find it stops when it hits a bit of land or a rock or something.
I see. And how do you steer?
I don't. I let the winds of fate sweep me where they will, you know?
How poetic.
I expect some of these ropes turn the sails round or something. I haven't tried all of them. Let's try that one. There, see. We're going in a different direction now.
Are we? What direction?
Downwards.
I really don't think the hole should be filling up with water like this. Are those holes in the sides supposed to be there?
Huh. Never noticed them before.
Can you swim?
No. I don't need to. I've got a boat.
I can't either. It's up to our chins, man. Aren't you worried?
Oh, I'm sure things will sort themselves out before.
Well, this is another fight.
We're both steaming drunk.
Edward!
Oh, you know what? Edward ain't home.
What? How do you know that?
Because I fucking murdered him.
I murdered Percy too.
We need more booze.
How'd you do it?
I heard Edward saying he was going to take out Percy's boat. So I fucking stabbed a hole in it.
Fuck!
What?
I punctured the boat too, last night, because I thought Percy was taking it out today.
No, Percy gave the boat to Ed. You'd gone up to get oil or whatever.
Hang on, there's a note on the table here.
It's from Percy. Dear Mary, going out for one last boat ride with Edward. Might be late for dinner. Tell Jane I love her. Oh my God. I drowned Percy.
Oh fucking murderers, Mary.
Team! Mary! Jay!
Wait. Hang on. If they were both in the same boat, right?
Right.
Then, like, Percy was in the boat you stabbed, and Ed was in the boat I stabbed. Doesn't that destroy the whole untraceable motives thing?
No. Because you stabbed it for Percy, and I stabbed it for Ed. There's no link.
But they might still reckon I did Ed, and you did.
You're adorable when you're confused. Come here.
What are they doing now?
Well, Bruno killed that firefly. That was Guy's wife. Now he's caught up with Guy at the other end of the train, and he's telling Guy that he has to give up his end of the bargain and kill Bruno's dad.
How are you getting all this from a couple snails crawling around a train set?
It is not a train set.
Oh, I've watched the movie A Bug's Life like 50 times?
Ants was infinitely preferable.
Yeah, but Woody Allen turned out to be a creep who married a much younger woman who is related to him.
Do you really want to go there, Edgar?
Where do you guys think Patricia went?
After Mary, maybe. Hey, you guys don't think Mary and Patricia might be gal pals?
Mary's not Patricia's type. Too much brains.
Oh, speak of the devil.
Huh. Three of them. Who's the new girl?
That's Jane, Mary's ex. Psycho.
Why does Patricia have them in handcuffs? Oh my god, you pervert!
No, Patricia's not handcuffs kinky. Snail kinky. Steel wool kinky. Way past handcuffs.
Gentlemen, what you are about to hear will shock you. I have to warn you that the Midnight Society may never see each other or the world the same way again.
With respect, Patricia, we hear that a lot. You gonna finish your story?
Oh, I'm gonna finish, bros. You all remember Mary's boyfriend, Percy?
Yeah, we've had Percy here a few times. Mary even let him talk once or twice.
Haven't seen him in a while, though.
You haven't. Oh, that must be because what was it? Oh, yeah, I remember. Percy's dead.
Oh. Oh, Mary won't be happy with him.
And you remember Jane's husband, Edward?
Jane's married? Mary, you sly fox.
I know, right?
Was married, Mr. Barker. Edward's also dead. Both murdered. And I got the hat to prove it.
Is this still about the snails?
You see, this top hat... Whoa!
What's that?
Something's clawing its way up out of the earth.
This is one of those end-of-the-night pranks, right? We're all going to run away screaming, and then Edgar takes his mask off and says a witty one-liner, right?
I'm sitting right here, Steve.
Is it a wet zombie?
That's not a wet zombie, that's...
Yoo-hoo!
Percy!
Hello, everybody!
Hi, Percy!
Percy, you're soaked to the skin.
Yes, dear.
And you're supposed to be dead.
Sorry, dear.
Ed's not back too, though, is he?
Hmm? No. He was eaten by a Swiss octopus on the way down.
Swiss? Oh, the horror!
But no axe of God, nor cephalopod, nor the eternal veil of death herself could keep me from returning to the true love of my life.
Oh. Oh, well, that's kind of sweet.
Jane Williams.
Oh, for fuck's sake, Percy.
Strangers on a train, exchanging murder, scheming on the train. We cross-referred our homicidal act. We do each other's deeds. No known links or threads of proof connect us. No police or feds. Who would suspect us? Quite the perfect crime to meet our morbid needs. Strangers on a train, so unfamiliar, we were strangers on a train. I said I'd kill your dad if you'd do in my spouse, sneak into my house. Freedom just a kill away, a dark forbidden thrill away. And ever since that ride, I've heard you taunt me, something in me died. Our victims haunt me, endless guilt and pain, for strangers on a train.
Submitted for the approval of the Midnight Pals, starred Rodrigo Borges as Edgar Allan Poe, Jason Robinson as Stephen Kane, Rebecca D'Souza as Mary Shelley, Sister Indica as Clive Barker, WREN Montgomery as Dean Koontz, and Robin Johnson as H.P. Lovecraft, with Kate DAVOLI as Patricia Highsmith, Hannah Brown as Jane Williams, Lou Sutcliffe as Percy Shelley, David Court as Edward Ellerker Williams, Julia Drake as Mrs. Cleveland, Canavan Connolly as the train engineer, Dexter Howard as Human Guy, Brad Barnes as Human Bruno, and special guest star Helen Arney as Mary Wollstonecraft, and Mike McShane as William Huskisson, MP. Elements of the novel Strangers on a Train by Patricia Highsmith and its film adaptation by Alfred Hitchcock are used with intent to parody. The music was by Robin Johnson. The theme song is performed by Helen Arney. The episode was directed and produced by Robin Johnson. Daisy McNamara was an audio consultant. This episode is dedicated to the memory of William Huskisson, MP. Submitted for the approval of the Midnight Pals is created by Bitter Corella. All characters are fictitious, especially the real ones. If you've enjoyed this episode, please consider leaving us a rating or a review on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or your favorite podcast platform. Find Submitted for the Approval of the Midnight Pals at midnightpals.com.
Freedom just to kill away, a dark forbidden thrill away, and ever since that ride, I've heard you taunt me, something in me died. Our victims haunt me, endless guilt and pain, for strangers on a train.
So, Bruno, now we've gotten away with the perfect murder. What do we do next?
Well, Guy, given all the homoerotic subtext in this story, we ride our train into the sunset and get married.
Oh, no, you don't. I can't marry you.
Why not?
Well, for one thing, we're both men, and it's the 1950s.
We'll have an unofficial ceremony.
I have a terrible past. I murdered a man's father for no reason.
I forgive you.
I can never have children.
We'll adopt.
But you don't understand.
I'm a snail.
Well, nobody's perfect.